Today on the Perception in Action podcast, a look at games-based approaches to coaching. How do methods like teaching games for understanding differ from the constraints-led approach? Is the CLA just old wine in new bottles, or does it add something new? So it's time for a call to action. Hi, everyone. This is Rob Gray from Arizona State University and PerceptionAction.com. Welcome to the Perception in Action podcast, where I discuss how psychological research can be applied to improving performance, accelerating skill acquisition, and designing technologies. In today's episode, I want to look at games-based approaches to coaching, considering very briefly its history and how it relates to the constraints-led approach, or CLA. For this, I'm going to give a brief overview of the approach and then look at two commentary articles. So game on. Games-based approaches to coaching, which can be traced back to the mid-70s in France and Germany and the early 80s in England, were a counter to the traditional assumption in coaching that athletes must master basic techniques before starting gameplay. Consistent with the basic ideas of what we now call representative learning design, developers of games-based approaches argued that traditional technique drills like dribbling around cones in soccer were overly simplified, unpressurized, and did not mimic the demands of real gameplay. Due to the complex and dynamic nature of sports, successful performance requires the interaction between tactical knowledge, decision-making, and skill execution. Thus, it was argued that traditional technical drills create a separation between technical and tactical knowledge, resulting in players that are not able to respond to and adjust to game situations. Games-based approaches were developed as an alternative way of learning within context, keeping these three elements unseparated, using game-like situations. The first formal games-based approach model was called Teaching Games for Understanding, or TGFU, proposed by Bunker and Thorpe in 1982. TGFU is a linear, cyclical, six-step model. The first step involves the coach deciding on a game form that matches the age and experience of the learners and has, quote-unquote, a close resemblance to the full game. By participating in these game-based activities, learners develop game appreciation, understanding the rules of the game, followed by tactical awareness. What are the best tactics to exploit these rules, including the strengths and weaknesses of opponents? Next, decision-making develops, which involves learning to recognize the cues and select the most appropriate response from those currently available to the individual. The next stage is skill execution, executing the chosen movement pattern. The emphasis here is on process over performance. For example, a younger athlete could make an appropriate choice and execute all the basic aspects of the skill, but may not have the strength needed to actually achieve the goal. Performance is considered in this final stage, where the observed outcome is assessed against criterion standards. At the end of the cycle, the teacher carefully evaluates each step and, if necessary, revises the game form to further challenge the learners. I will come back to this model in more detail in a moment. Since TGFU first appeared, several other games-based approaches with slight variations have been developed, for example, Game Sense. In their 2018 review of this area, Kinnerick and colleagues describe four common features of games-based approaches. 1. The design and manipulation of practice games and activities. 2. The use of questioning. 3. Providing opportunities for dialogue. And 4. Building a supportive social environment for learning. In their paper, Kinnerick et al. Performed a systematic review and identified 23 studies that have researched these different aspects of game-based approaches. So let's look at each of these aspects in turn. The first feature of TGFU involves the coach designing a learning environment that engages the athlete through the use of modified and/or conditioned games, as opposed to isolated, technically focused drills. A critical question that has been explored in a few research studies is, do athletes actually effectively develop tactical and technical skill using a games-based approaches? And does it occur at a rate that is similar to more traditional technique-focused drills? For tactical development, the research seems to strongly support the benefits of games-based approaches. Kinnerick and colleagues identified 6 studies that explored this issue, and in 5 there were significant improvements in various aspects of decision-making and skills, like off-the-ball adjustments and covering other players in soccer. But as far as technical skill development goes, this still seems to be a bit of an open question. Consistent with the views of many opponents of games-based approaches, only 2 out of the 6 of the studies found by Kinnerick et al. In their review was there evidence of improvement of technical skill. As an example and for more detail, let's look at the study by Pizarro and colleagues published in 2017. In this study, a quasi-experimental design was used in which 9 youth soccer players, aged 10 to 11, completed 6 training sessions using a traditional technique-based drills approach for passing and dribbling, followed by 22 sessions based on a TGFU approach over a 12-week period. Within this TGFU portion of the training, several different aspects of the tasks were modified. For example, attack game principles, number of players, opposition level, equal or unequal number of players on each team, space, goal, and time. To emphasize the development of different tactical and technical abilities, for example, passing decisions, shooting, covering, and marking. Questioning was carried out twice for each task. Questions were focused on tactical principles to be dealt with during each task. For example, why did you decide to pass to player 1 versus player 2? What made you decide which was the best moment to pass? The number of appropriate and inappropriate passing and dribbling actions were recorded from the decision execution viewpoint using the game performance evaluation tool. Skill execution of passing and dribbling were scored on a scale from 0 to 2 based on whether the pass was too hard or too soft, led the receiver appropriately, whether the control of the ball was maintained, etc. Performance was compared at 3 time points: during the initial 6-week technical training, so before the TGFU intervention, halfway through the TGFU training, that is after 11 sessions, and at the end of 22 sessions of TGFU training. What was found? First, there were no significant improvements for any of the measures after 11 sessions. This finding is somewhat consistent with the idea that things develop at a slower rate in games-based approaches. After 22 weeks, there were significant improvements in both decision-making and execution for passing, while only decision-making improved for dribbling. How effectively tactical and technical abilities develop in games-based approaches and at what relative rate is something that needs to be addressed in future research, where different approaches are directly compared. A key to the effectiveness of methods like TGFU is, of course, planning and designing effective games. Research has shown that this is something that doesn't just come right away to many coaches, as it requires some education and training. For example, Shane Pill reported that it took nearly a year for a coach in his study to become highly skilled and comfortable with implementing a games-based approach in practice. In terms of designing the games, there are 4 pedagogical principles used in TGFU: sampling, tactical complexity, modification representation, and modification exaggeration. Sampling involves using different game examples from the same category to provide learners with an understanding of similar tactical problems and solutions. Tactical complexity refers to the idea that there's a developmental progression of tactical solutions that must be systematically increased. Representation involves game-like scenarios that represent how a particular skill or tactical solution is used within a game. Finally, exaggeration involves creating a scenario that exaggerates a principle being taught. For example, using a small-sided game to exaggerate changes in spacing between players. To foreshadow what I'm going to talk about in a moment, 2 of these principles, representation design and exaggeration, may sound very similar to what is done in the constraints-led approach. However, and not surprisingly, research has also provided evidence that coaches frequently use games in practice that conflict with these basic pedagogical principles. Returning to the review article by Kinnerick and colleagues, the 2nd and 3rd features of games-based approaches are the use of questioning and opportunities for dialogue and reflection. Research evaluating games-based approaches has highlighted that shifting to this questioning-reflection approach is one of the most difficult for coaches. Issues included ineffective questions and feedback, and players not liking being asked questions. As I've discussed in past episodes, the shift from the coach as an instructor, I have the answer, here it is, to more of a designer and facilitator, you are going to be actively involved and I'm going to help you find the answer, is a very large and difficult change at times. Reviewing the final feature of games-based approaches, building a supportive social and moral environment, there seems to be 2 critical issues that arise. Promoting psychological safety, that is creating a practice environment where failure is okay and expected, and acknowledging that affect and emotion, both from players and the coaches, are part of the practice environment, an issue I discussed back in episode 130. To further understand games-based approaches like TGFU, let's look at a question that I mentioned a few moments ago. How does this approach relate to the CLA? This was addressed in detail in an article published by Renshaw and colleagues in 2016. Note, I'm going to start by looking at what was said in their article and then follow it up by looking at a response article that challenges some of its claims. Renshaw et al.'s impetus for writing their article was comments they had received from reviewers of their papers that TGFU and CLA are basically the same thing and that both are built on the same underlying principles. This is also a sentiment that seems to be frequently expressed on Twitter. As the authors note, part of the misunderstanding is likely due to the fact that a lot of the early papers in the CLA literature focused on team games as a choice of sport. One of the points they make in their paper is that while the CLA can be used to support team games, it can also be extended to many other areas of physical activity and individual sports. Another key difference they emphasize is that TGFU is really a more practical model, while CLA is more theoretically focused. Quote, TGFU has been developed as an operational model for the practice of teachers of physical education, whereas the CLA is a theoretically based approach to skill acquisition and motor learning that can be applied to developing principles of practice across the whole spectrum of exercise, health, PE, sports performance, and physical activity. End quote. They begin their article by going into a bit of a review of the history and emergence of TGFU. They emphasize that it was based on the fundamental idea that game skills could be taught from the principles of play, and it was a practical approach aimed at improving learning. As Thorpe noted in a conference presentation at the time, quote, advocates of TGFU ask themselves the question, have we concentrated too much on how we coach rather than how they learn, end quote. TGFU represented a movement from a teacher-centered to a learner-centered approach to teaching game skills. There was a movement away from focusing on the mechanics of teaching, for example, how to project one's voice and manage classes, to assessing the learning experience and environment. According to the authors, one of the key differences between TGFU and the CLA is the former originated as a pedagogical method and was not explicitly built on any theory of motor control and learning. Since its conception, it has subsequently been linked with a few different theories, mostly by people that were not originally involved in its development. For example, it has been sometimes linked with cognitive theories of motor learning like schema theory, and it has also been proposed that the CLA or principles of nonlinear pedagogy could best explain why games-based approaches are successful. So if the CLA can be used to explain its effects, there must be some similarities between it and the TGFU. Let's look at what these are. Note, I'm not going to give a detailed description of the constraints-led approach here. For that, please check out my series on the topic beginning with episode 87. The first similarity is that in both the TGFU and CLA, athletes find their own solutions to movement problems through a process of guided discovery in the former and self-organization in the latter. These solutions emerge in the face of conditions, rules, and/or constraints put in place by the teacher or coach. Because of this similarity, these methods share the common criticism I discussed a few moments ago that it takes longer for technical skills to develop. A second similarity is that both approaches acknowledge and embrace the fact that there are individual differences between learners. For example, both attempt to match the design of task demands and/or the constraints to the current capabilities of the learner. A third similarity is one that I also mentioned a few moments ago, the changing role of the teacher or coach. In both approaches, the role is more as a hands-off facilitator to guide a performer's discovery, with the performer or student taking responsibility for their own learning. In the TGFU, the game acts as the teacher, while in the CLA, it lies in the individual environment interactions. The final similarity is one that is likely obvious from my description so far. Both approaches emphasize representative design and practice based on the principles put forth by Brunswick. For the TGFU, it is effectively sampling from the game and designing activities, while in the CLA, it is ensuring that similar affordances in the learning environment are available in the performance environment. Okay, now what are the major differences between the TGFU and CLA? The first and most prominent one is the underlying processes that are proposed to be involved in skill development. Although both emphasize self-discovery, in the TGFU, a much greater emphasis is placed on cognitive processing. In particular, games-based approaches such as TGFU emphasize that understanding is a critical part of developing skill. This presumably involves developing mental models, representation, and schema for activities. With its underpinnings in ecological psychology, the CLA, of course, argues that learning sports skills does not require elaborate cognitive processing before a movement solution can be discovered and used. Instead, these solutions emerge through a search through perceptual motor space. On the one hand, in the CLA, knowledge of a performance environment comes from interacting with it, becoming attuned to specifying information sources, picking up affordances, and developing movement information couplings. On the other hand, in the stage model of the TGFU I discussed a few moments ago, knowledge about the performance environment precedes decision-making, which precedes execution of action. Within the TGFU, the goal is to develop declarative and procedural knowledge to make intelligent players who know what to do and how best to do it. A final way to express this difference can be seen in the following quote from the article. The aim in TGFU is to improve performance by developing understanding through changing, constructing, or enriching knowledge structures or cognition, with understanding being located in the mind or in the brain. In contrast, the CLA aims to change, adapt, or attune the nature of the emerging learner environment system. Here, it is each individual's relationship to his specific environmental properties that changes with learning. Over time, this relationship can become more functional, allowing the achievement of task goals fluently, accurately, and efficiently. End quote. A second difference between the TGFU and CLA is the emphasis on the role of questioning in practice design. As I discussed a few moments ago, posing questions and reflective activity of the learner is a core part of the learning process, an essential element in any games-based approach. Conversely, in the CLA, questioning is just one possible way among many that a coach can constrain the learning process. Because, of course, in the CLA, there is no need for conscious regulation of movement, this kind of questioning and reflection is not a necessary part of skill acquisition. The third difference between the two approaches, according to Renshaw and colleagues, is how learning progresses and the linearity of the process. Quote, TGFU has a progressive linear-like cyclical structure within sessions, in which the complexity of the games and challenges is increased as learners develop. The key to progression is the ability of the teacher to make modifications to the starter game, leading to a careful reappraisal of the requirements of the new game. End quote. In contrast, and as I've discussed in previous episodes like number 171, learning in the CLA is a non-linear process, where the stages of search, discovering, and exploiting perceptual degrees of freedom are nested together and do not occur sequentially. They are concurrent processes of exploration and reinforcement. The final difference concerns whether there's any role for out-of-context, non-representative traditional skill drills in the learning process. Within the TGFU approach, it is often recommended that traditional skill drills be interjected within games-based learning, with the learner being temporarily pulled out of the game context. In the CLA, this is generally discouraged, with instead the preference being to simplify the task and use constraint manipulations in environments that are still representative of the performance environment. As I mentioned, not everyone agrees with Renshaw's and colleagues' assessment, and a response article was published by Harvey and colleagues in 2018. These authors have two main contentions. The first is with the claim that TGFU was primarily developed as a practical operational model with no initial theoretical grounding. Second, they argue that the key feature of the CLA, representative learning design through the manipulation of constraints, is far from new. With regards to their first point, Harvey et al. Provided a detailed discussion of the history and development of games-based approaches that I'm not going to detail here. Their main point is that right from the beginning, it was based on theory. They emphasize two of the main theoretical constructs underlying TGFU, discovery learning and the notion of understanding. It is here where they also point out a major difference between games-based approaches and the CLA. In the CLA, learning is thought to occur largely implicitly, with little or any conscious awareness or conscious regulation of movements during skill execution. Conversely, in games-based approaches like TGFU, learning is thought to be highly explicit, with skill relying on cognitive processing and conscious understanding of technique and tactics. In Harvey and colleagues' view, the idea that skills are acquired implicitly through a process of exploration and self-organization in the face of constraints, in other words, the CLA, is inferior to the cognitive theory, with an emphasis on understanding through a cycle of play, reflect, play, on which the TGFU is built. To support this view, the authors point to research from education showing that explicit learning through guided discovery is more effective than implicit learning through unassisted discovery. Quote, in two meta-analyses examining the effects of unassisted discovery learning versus explicit instruction and the effects of enhanced or unassisted discovery versus other types of instruction, findings suggested that unassisted discovery does not benefit learners in comparison to feedback, worked examples, scaffolding, and elicited explanations. And, quote, we contend that evidence cited above suggests caution in the messages that are sent to practitioners using the CLA, that simply manipulating constraints and letting the game be the teacher is a sufficient condition for learning to occur. Indeed, while procedural knowledge may develop, such as knowing that you cannot score in a certain goal, without bolstering this with explicit instruction and guidance, the development of knowledge may continue to be extremely immature and variable. End quote. So in sum, Harvey and colleagues are arguing that the development of the TGFU and other games-based approaches to coaching were always theoretically driven, and they rely on a very different theoretical approach from that of the CLA. Before moving to their second point regarding the novelty of the CLA, I want to make a few points here myself. First, the question of whether it's better to acquire skills implicitly or explicitly is still an open empirical issue that's up for debate. The evidence Harvey and colleagues present in their paper is mostly from education studies involving highly cognitive tasks that are likely to have a bigger role for explicit knowledge and understanding and involve different processes than sports skills. In their paper, they also fail to consider the research which has shown the potential benefits of implicit learning on motor skills, for example, that by Masters and colleagues, which I discuss in episodes 16 and 116. Finally, it should also be noted that in the studies Harvey et al. Cite, guided discovery was compared to unassisted learning. As I have hopefully explained in my previous episodes, the CLA is not unassisted learning. The learner's movement through the solution space is guided by the effective use of constraints by the coach. So, arguing that explicit knowledge is essential for skill acquisition is a hypothesis and is far from a matter of fact. Turning to the author's second major point, they argue that the ideas of representative design and game modification through constraints are not new. Quote, consequently, while ecological dynamics theorists suggest designing representative, exaggerating learning episodes for their students and players is a key feature of the CLA, this concept is far from new. For example, in 1982, Bailey noted condition games were part of our stock and trade as PE teachers, and these features have been central to all the alternative games-based approaches since the introduction of the TGFU. End quote. Several alternative games-based approaches share core features similar to the CLA proposition, such as modifying game constraints, representation of the full game form in designer games, etc., which may render any new games-based approach that has these features such as the CLA as old wine in new bottles. End quote. And so in other words, CLA is just adding a new terminology and new wrapping to methods that have been around for a long time. I'm not going to spend too much time challenging this point because it's something I've already discussed in detail back in episode 163 when asking why do we constrain in the CLA. The key points I was making then is that within the CLA, concepts like self-organization and constraints have highly specific meanings and definitions derived from dynamical systems ideas and the work of people like Kelso, Turvey, and Newell. In that previous episode, I highlighted the difference between manipulating conditions, which has been done previously in games-based approaches, and manipulating constraints. These two things have very different purposes, promoting self-organization versus promoting understanding. As specific evidence of this difference and why it is not old wine, as I discussed in my last episode, the CLA makes specific predictions and can explain the coordination solutions that emerge from a practice environment and how the performer will learn to control the degrees of freedom of movement. Previous approaches based on cognitive theories and the manipulation of conditions have absolutely nothing to say about the process of coordination, as they are focused on the cognitive processes and knowledge that are acquired in learning. So while the actual manipulations used in the CLA may look the same to games-based approaches like the TGFU to the naked eye, they are used and understood in a different and new way in comparison to earlier work in this area. Finally, I should also point out that the concept of representative learning design has added a lot more to the idea of quote-unquote bringing the game into practice. For example, it allows us to understand specifically which aspects of the competitive environment we need to attempt to replicate in practice and which we don't. In the end, I think it's best to keep the CLA separate from games-based approaches like TGFU, because as Harvey and colleagues conclude, quote, TGFU and CLA may look alike, but they rest on different theoretical foundations, end quote. To sum up, in today's episode, I looked at games-based approaches to coaching, focusing on teaching games for understanding, a method that has been around since the 70s and that seeks to develop understanding and game intelligence in a performer through guided discovery involving questioning and reflection. In my opinion, even though both involve quote-unquote letting the game be the teacher, games-based approaches and the CLA are very different and should not be lumped together. If you are a coach, I think the one you choose will depend on your beliefs about the relative importance of explicit knowledge, conscious regulation of actions, and understanding and skill acquisition. Is your goal to manipulate conditions of practice so that the performers can gain technical and tactical knowledge and hopefully develop movement solutions and decisions that are close to some ideal? Or is your goal to manipulate constraints that encourage performers to explore the space to find and exploit their own movement solutions? I will let you decide. Okay, that's it for today's episode. Remember, you can contact me at robgray@asu.edu or follow me on Twitter at ShakeyWeights. To find out more about the podcast, please check out perceptionaction.com. Finally, to support the podcast and receive bonus materials, including written transcripts, please head over to patreon.com/perceptionaction. This is Rob Gray from ASU. Cheers for now, and keep them coupled. Yeah,